have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Let us then confess our sins to God our Father.
Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways with the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all of your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
comfort in him, obey his voice with all our hearts, and obtain eternal salvation. Your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one true God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated. Old Testament reading for the third Sunday of Easter is from Ezekiel chapter 34. For thus says the Lord God, behold, I myself will search my sheep and will seek them out. As a shepherd seeks out his flock when he is among his sheep that have been scattered, so will I seek out my sheep, and I will rescue them from all places where they have been scattered, on a day of clouds and a day of darkness. And I will bring them out from the peoples, and gather them from the countries, and will bring them into their own land. And I will feed them on the mountains of Israel by the ravines, and in all the inhabited places of the country. I will feed them with good pasture, and on the mountain heights of Israel shall be their grazing land. There they shall lie down in good grazing land, and on rich pasture they shall feed on the mountains of Israel. I myself will be the shepherd of my sheep, and I myself will make them lie down, declares the Lord God. I will seek the lost, and I will bring back the strayed, and I will bind up the injured, and I will strengthen the weak, and the fat and the strong I will destroy. I will feed them in justice. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Continued entrusting himself to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed, for you were straying like sheep, but have now returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Yeah.
Sunday of Easter. And what we observe about those first readings, Easter Day and Sunday after Easter, it's John, and it's John again, same chapter, chapter 20, is that this really is about the history. So it's the names and the dates and the places and those kinds of things. It's the appearance of the risen Christ, to be sure. So, hallelujah, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
And so the women observe the resurrected Lord. Later, the disciples observe the resurrected Lord. There's a little bit of talk about the ministry and Jesus sending them into the world with the gospel, with this good news of Christ risen for the forgiveness of sins. But mainly, this is about the history, the names, the dates, the places. That's John chapter 20. And now that we've come to this third Sunday of Easter, there's a little bit of reflection now as to what this means to have a Christ who suffered and died and a Christ who has risen from the grave. There's a little reflection by way of this idea of the Good Shepherd that helps us to think about who Christ is for us. He is our Good Shepherd. And who we are to him. We are his flock. We are the sheep. We are the people for whom he died and rose so that we might have life and salvation. And so Jesus declares here, for all to hear, that Jesus is, I am the Good Shepherd. And when we hear that, yes, he's the Good Shepherd, and we have to think about it. What does it mean for him to be the Shepherd? What does it mean for him to be good? Well, by worldly standards, and I always talk about it this way for whatever reason, by worldly standards, what Jesus does is not exactly good, is not exactly in the shepherd's manual of how to run a business and how to manage your sheep, because he dies. Shepherds are shepherds for a reason, right? They want to put food on the table, they want to take care of their families, they want to be able to pay their bills. After all, it's basically a business. And so for shepherds, like for anybody else, it's about minimizing your costs, not being deceitful or misleading people. It's about maximizing your profits, right? So you're making best use of what you have. It's about really using these sheep to the best of your ability to generate the kinds of things that you need to live, to survive, even to thrive in this life. So by worldly standards, that's what a good shepherd really is. Successful small businessman or something along those lines. But Jesus here is not interested in those kinds of worldly standards in any way whatsoever. Jesus is not interested in maximizing profits or minimizing losses or any of those kinds of things. Jesus is the Good Shepherd in a totally different way, in fact, in a completely radical kind of way. Because by worldly standards, you look at Jesus and what he does, and you say, he's not the Good Shepherd. But who or which group of people will see what Jesus does in terms of his life and his death and his resurrection? Which group of people will see what Jesus does and declare him absolutely to be the Good Shepherd? And who is that group? Well, that's the sheep, right? That's us. That's the church. Because we recognize that in terms of interest, Jesus was not self-interested. In terms of interest, Jesus was not trying to maximize profits or anything along those lines. But Jesus is the Good Shepherd for us because when it comes to that time when we need to have a shepherd, a person who's looking out for us, a person who defends us, who feeds us, who waters us, who's looking over us, he's the overseer. He's our bishop in that sense. Well, that's just the person we want. That's just the person we need because we are the sheep. And we are being persecuted and hunted by the wolves. And when that good shepherd steps in and does all those good things for us, we all together say, he is the good shepherd. Look at what he has done for us. He is the good shepherd. Look at what he does for us. Well, by contrast, you have the hired hand. That's more along the worldly lines here that Jesus is talking about. The hired hand, his business is, he has a body, he's renting out this body basically to work. So his concern definitely is for himself. And so when he sees the trouble, he sees the wolf, he sees the danger, what he says is, I didn't sign up for this, I wasn't hired to die for these sheep, I'm out of here, I'm out of here, right? And that's the contrast that I'm talking about. That's the worldly standard that I'm talking about. Jesus doesn't abide by the worldly standard. Jesus isn't merely the hireling. In fact, he is the owner. He is our creator. He is thoroughly invested in us in that he gives us life in terms of our creation. He's thoroughly invested in us in that he even gives his life so that we might have life, overcoming the power of sin, death, and the devil, which was even in the colic, which I misread. So this Jesus, he is the good shepherd. We know this. And now this is the summary idea. This is the summary statement of how we're supposed to think about Jesus. We're sheep in the sense we have need. We're sheep in the sense that we need a shepherd. And Jesus is that shepherd. Jesus is that good shepherd. He does all these things for us and for our salvation. And then he adds this little line about how he knows his sheep and his sheep know him. And you could simply just sort of gloss over that and think it's just kind of part of the poetic structure here of the parable or the poetic structure of the teaching. But there's real theology here. There's something really important here for us to recognize and to understand. And it goes to the reason why the Christ had to come in the first place. It goes to the reason why Jesus had to take on human flesh, suffer, die, and rise, so that we might have this thing. And what it is this. If you go back and you think about the garden, which I know we do regularly, which is good, and we think about the original creation, Adam and Eve and God, and there you have a kind of a shepherding situation in the sense of God is God, they are his people. He's looking out for them. He is protecting them. He is conversing with them. He is with them. He's in communion with them. That's the word that we use. He's in communion with them. And once that sin comes into the situation, once the devil begins to speak, once Adam and Eve begin to listen and to follow those words rather than the word of God, once they eat from the forbidden fruit, and sin is definitely at work, that communion's broken. God and man are not together. God and Adam and Eve are not together. There's a separation there. There's a distance there. And whereas God, on his part, still extends love and desires good things for the creation, even though they have sinned against him, the problem is it's Adam and Eve. Adam and Eve and their descendants are the ones now who begin to harden their hearts. Adam and Eve now are the ones who are the wayward sheep who want nothing to do with Good Shepherd. Adam and Eve and all of their descendants, namely us, we are the ones who want to go our own way with no knowledge of what's out there. We are the ones who want to chart our own path with no knowledge of what's out there. Sin, death, and the devil, the wolf who seeks the sheep so that he might destroy them. But when the Christ comes, in fulfillment of the scriptures, when Jesus takes on human flesh, lives in our place under the law, suffers and dies and rises, you have to say this, the world's entirely different as a consequence. Because the promises of God are no longer just promises to be fulfilled, they have been fulfilled. And this is a new world, this is a new creation. This is the beginning of life everlasting in this world still with its troubles and its difficulties facing us, to be sure. But we're looking ahead and we can see everlasting life coming in our direction faster and faster every day. And so when Jesus talks here about his sheep now, those for whom he has died, those he has washed by way of his own blood, those he has granted faith to understand and to know exactly who he is in relationship to them, he is their good shepherd. He is our good shepherd. Well, we recognize him. We recognize him in his word. Those are Christ's words. Those aren't worldly words. Those aren't words that deceive us like the serpent. These are words where there's health and salvation to be found. And we listen to him the way sheep listen to their shepherd. He protects us and defends us in the ways that I've been talking about. He feeds us and waters us with his own body and his own blood in the sacrament of the altar. And so he really has become our shepherd, and we really have become his people. And we have that relationship restored with him. We have that relationship, that communion restored with him. But not only that, I recognize my sheep, they recognize me, just as I recognize the Father recognizes me, and both that means is, and what that's about is, that we now have a restored peace, a restored communion with the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now, Jesus is the way we come into that. Jesus is the sole mediator between God and man. That's true. But what it really means is all those things that were lost in the fall in terms of communion with God, all of those wonderful gifts and benefits that came before the fall in terms of life with God, free from sin, well, these are the things that you now have because of Christ, his death and his resurrection. These are the things that the shepherd has granted to his sheep because he has died for them, died in their place, rose from the grave. And this is exactly the kinds of things that he wants to distribute to his sheep. Good things for them, for their health, for their salvation, for their life with him forevermore. Well, you get that understanding going, and now you see the importance and the significance of thinking of Jesus as our shepherd and we as his sheep. But there is a way of thinking about this that's basically too narrow. It's a way of thinking about this as if Jesus only died, say, for people in this room. Or Jesus only died and rose, say, for the disciples. Or for the Jews. Or some limited kind of a group. But what Jesus tells us here right up front is that when it comes to his life, his death, his resurrection, when it comes to his being the good shepherd, it's not in a limited sense, just say for the disciples or the Jews or say people in this room. But Jesus, because of what he has done, has become the good shepherd for a great, numerous kind of a people. Like the stars of the sky and the sands of the seashore. This is the fulfillment of it. And it's people from the past, all the way back to Adam and Eve, say. And it's people in the future, of whom we have no direct knowledge of, because they're in the future, and they don't yet exist. It's for people here, it's for people there, it's for people everywhere. Because Christ has died for the sins of the world. Christ's resurrection is new life for sinners in this world. And from the time of his resurrection, and now thinking back to what happened in John chapter 20, Jesus, God, has the desire of bringing those sheep into his sheepfold. Bringing sinners into the sheepfold. Bringing sinners to the place where the waters are to be found. Bringing sinners into the place where there's green grass for grazing. The good green grass that grants us life and salvation. And we're just a part of this, but I want to make sure we understand this. We are a part of this. We are a part of the holy people of God. We are a part of the holy church of God, called out of this world by God himself, being called into a world in which there is no sin. And he does all of these things, even allows for a son to suffer, even allows for a son to die, and of course to rise. For you. For you and for your salvation. For you to bring you into the sheepfold. For you, because of his love for you. This is the reason why God does all the things that he does. This is the reason why God has done specifically the things that he has done for us in Christ. And so Jesus is, as he says, he is the good shepherd. In fact, he is our good shepherd. And for this we offer our thanks. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Peace of God that passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. We rise. And we continue with the prayers of the church. Let us pray for the whole church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the increase of faith in Christ for our sins, and for inspiration to follow him, who suffered and did not threaten, who is judged and did not condemn. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the church, that God would send faithful shepherds to care for his flock here and scattered throughout the world, that he would keep them devoted to Christ and his truth, and so turn them in dutiful service toward his people. For St. Thomas Lutheran Church that was chartered on this day and has been received into the fellowship of Lutheran Church with their sin. This congregation will always be a place where sinners go to find solace, where Christ will always be proclaimed as crucified and resurrected for the forgiveness of sins. even in those places where poor now is at work. Let us praise the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
In thanksgiving for our risen Christ, the first fruits of death, who has secured forgiveness for our troubled consciences, that he would also bless those who suffer, especially Ursula, Lorraine, Bob, Tammy Rose, Jeanette, Deborah, Ingeborg, Gladys, Robin, Mark, Joanne, and Teresa, that he would bring Christ presents his body and blood to us for forgiveness. That you take note of and give thanks for the boundless love that he showed us when he saved us from the wrath of God, sin, death, and hell by his blood. And that you then externally receive the bread and wine that is his body and blood as a guaranteed pledge. Let us then, in his name, according to his command, and with his own words, administer and receive the testimony. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly meet, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God. And most especially are we bound to praise you on this day for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, the very Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and bore the sins of the world. By his dying, he has destroyed death. And by his rising again, he has restored to us everlasting life. Therefore, with Mary Magdalene, Peter and John, and with all the witnesses of the resurrection, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying,
thank you.
And we ask you not to forsake your children, but always to rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that we may be enabled constantly to serve you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Peace.